Hi, my name is Ann Kroman, and I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist. I'm at the Medical University of South Carolina, where we are big fans and big believers in the Barostim. Again, that's where Dr. Mike Zeil is and Dr. Michael Gold, who's also here in the audience, but some of our big kind of founders in the original development and the physiology behind this device. And, you know, I'm going to change gears a little bit from what my colleagues have discussed. Dr. Singh gave us just a fantastic kind of overview of why Barostim, how it works, the trials, the data in there, the physiology as well. And I think that's crucial for us all to understand and to recognize. And I think that's really what we're getting at here with a device that physiologically makes sense for these certain patients. And we've also discussed the problems with multiple leads in the heart, I mean, extractor as well. And I also spent a lot of time taking the things out of the heart in cases of infection or fracture. And I also echo the sentiments that I believe we're going towards a very patient personalized, even maybe considered a modular type of approach with a variety of different devices that we can use, be it leadless, be it CRT, be it sub-Q, be it Barostim, to really tailor devices to the patient. I'm a big proponent of right device for the right patient, and that's not just for pacers, ICDs. I think that extends to our whole armamentarium of devices now that we can implant. So my kind of focus for this is gonna be a little bit about how do we bring Barostim and where are we going from here, and some exciting work and research we've been doing kind of in the phase two. Heard about BATHF. This is a new trial, the BATWIRE trial. And again, as we've all kind of known and seen, the elements of this device is encompassed by the carotid sinus lead. Again, to emphasize, this is an extravascular lead that needs to deliver its impulses to the carotid body. During the traditional implant, this is done with directly suturing this lead tip onto the area of the carotid body. However, as I'll show you, we're sort of transitioning and trialing into a way that this can be delivered through a more minimally invasive approach. We still have to have that electrode near that carotid body that we're looking at. Again, this lead is tunneled to kind of a standard. I also do kind of right deltopectoral groove incision, similar to other devices, usually on the right, opposite of patients' already existing devices, which are housed on the left. So as we've seen before, Dr. Honigsberg talked about this. This is the traditional way that the Barostim device is implanted by a vascular surgeon. And I know that I'm very fortunate to work very closely with my vascular surgery colleagues. A lot of us are. Some of us are not. And this can be one potential identified barrier to really being able to get this device fully to the patient population that we need to, is that there's a vascular surgery component to it for the device implant. And this is sort of the impetus to start to think about, you know, as we as EPs in our EP toolbox, devices are what we do day in and day out. How do we take this device and add this to something, make it a implanted procedure that we can do routinely in our EP lab as we are normally used to? So again, current procedure requires OR surgical team, a little bit of a skin incision, even though it can be very minimal, depending with a good vascular surgeon, and exposure, direct visualization of the carotid artery is how this lead is directly sewn on. So in the BATWIRE trial and the changes to the device and changes to the delivery system, we've really tried to come up with a way to make this device implantable in an EP cath lab type situation. Again, no fluoro needed in this one, but with a very just small skin incision, and then again, your standard pocket incision, which is going to be required for the pulse generator for this device as well. So a more minimally invasive procedure, and a procedure that an electrophysiologist can do unaided by a vascular surgeon. So we've already kind of gone through some of the eligibility criteria for the Barostim device and the Barostim implant itself. And I don't want to belabor those. What I did want to talk about is a little bit of the different kind of inclusion criteria that we're starting to think about when we look at actually delivering this lead minimally invasive. And a lot of this goes to actually looking at the anatomy of the carotid vasculature and the anatomy of the neck itself. So right now we kind of screen patients using a variety of different approaches and different imaging studies, both with carotid duplex ultrasound as well as with CTA. to make sure that we have a good target that we can get to. And I think that's key and crucial to understand, and that'll play a big role in how we start to develop and adjust this technology as it rolls out, is we want to have an adequate landing zone. If we're doing it in a more minimally invasive, we can't rely just strictly on that direct visualization and moving things out of the way with retractors. So that is important. And also BMI does play a role in this, and a lot just due to neck size, neck anatomy, being able to effectively deliver that lead close enough to the carotid body that the Barostim itself is actually effective and can get down to the target area. So the kind of revised kit that has been developed as a way to minimally invasively deliver this lead, again, it's relied upon vascular ultrasound. And as EP has evolved, this is all something that has pretty much become standard of care, in my opinion, as far as getting access for different procedures. I think we've all become very facile in looking at things vascularly with ultrasound. That's a key kind of component to this, and I'll kind of show and walk through some slides of how that's done. But that's used to identify our target structure. And then it uses the kind of ability of a way to essentially deliver through a needle and a sheath-like structure to land that lead right over the carotid body, then with just tunneling the lead down to the pocket for the pulse generator itself. So again, this is a little bit about the implant technique, and I'll show you some of our imaging as well. So again, heavily reliable on ultrasound, which I think we are all fairly facile with, and it just takes a little bit of training and skill and just a change in what you think about anatomy-wise and what you're looking at, instead of, we're all, in my training, certainly IGA-centric and wanted to be as far away from the carotid as possible. And now it's kind of changed into really understanding the carotid anatomy and how that looks on ultrasound. So again, once that target site is chosen, ultrasound-guided wire is delivered to advance it right through that area, right above the carotid body and sort of the carotid sheath. Again, then a guide wire and sheath-type system is advanced over that, and that is where that is then split, laying the lead right on top of your target sites. Once that lead is in place, there's no need for the suturing down onto the carotid body. That lead will stay in place after the splitting of the delivery system. And then the lead is then tunneled down to the pulse generator pocket, as we've discussed before. So just some images here. This is me and my vascular surgery colleague, Dr. Jean Ruddy. She likes the lights and the green type of format in the OR for the ultrasound. So here's us doing some of the BATWIRE minimally invasive implants. And again, kind of, and I'll let this play through a couple times, is we spend a lot of time in the prep on this, and especially this is how we're getting used to and trialing the technology. A lot of time and precision is spent with us even looking at ultrasound, identifying structures. And as we all can know and understand, neck and head position does come into play with this. We want to, again, sort of almost get the roll that IJ away from the side of the carotid. We scroll through the carotid, you identify the bifurcation. Once we identify that transversely, then we flip to the longitudinal type of origin. And you can see that there's that large kind of carotid bulb, carotid body. With that, even you can see on ultrasound that fibrous sheath that covers it. Once we've identified our targets and our landmarks, then we work on advancing the needle and wire system, again, while frequently switching back, looking at our targets both in longitudinally as well as transverse sections, slowly advancing the needle. So you see we're getting kind of deeper. We do want to be able to really land that right over the carotid body system. We are still far enough away from the carotid not to be in fear of puncturing the carotid, obviously. That is something we want to be cognizant of. But you can really, that sheath is large enough that you can get above the carotid body itself without worrying about puncturing directly into the carotid as well. Once this lead is delivered in place, we do a series of testing, as is usually done for the Barostim implant. The device is activated on. It's pretty remarkable, and I would encourage anybody who's interested in it and anybody who has a vascular surgeon at their center who is doing this you know, go to the OR even when they do the traditional ones, and it's remarkable just the change in the arterial blood pressure line with the Barostim, changes in pulse rate. It's just a fascinating exercise in physiology and motion, and we get to see that here as well. So it's wonderful. The sheets are withdrawn, the pocket is closed as usual, and then patient is. We in this phase of study, we keep them overnight, still do all the neurologic monitoring. But the hope is that this will be an easy transition to having this be housed more as a regular device implant in our EP lab, home the same day, very, again, minimally invasive, starting to take that in a different realm. And I think that will help us provide greater access of this device to a larger patient population who really, truly would benefit from this this device and this physiology. So again, just in summary, as I don't need to reiterate, because I think we have shown it in spades, that there's great physiology and technology behind this. It's a wonderful option for these patients. And I think, you know, thinking about an EP toolbox and a big armamentarium of different devices, different therapies, different techniques that we can use with patients is crucial. And hopefully this is one way that we can take the Barostim and continue to tailor it, continue to refine it, and make it more easily implantable for EPs overall. Thank you.